Good morning, friends. I'm happy to be here again to discuss another concept in research methodology paper. Now let us discuss about unit 9.3 and 9.4. 9.3, it talks about the research design, selection of research problem, review of literature, formulation of research problem, hypothesis, the formulation types and testing hypothesis, and sampling techniques. Let's begin a session. So what is a research design? See, before you start doing a research, you sit and plan what are the various steps involved in conducting or carrying out your research work. Just like when you plan to construct a house, you prepare a rough draft, you prepare a layout, you prepare a blueprint that will guide you to construct each and every phase of your total construction process. The same way, while you are going to carry out a research work, you have a rough idea, you decide well in advance what you are going to do. So that kind of a blueprint is called as a research design. So research design is a conceptual structure. You're going to prepare a structure within which you are going to operate the entire research work. You can say it is a blueprint that tells the people what is your research, how you're going to collect data, how you're going to analyze the data, and how you're going to present the results. It's a blueprint. You can say it's an outline, which outlines, which tells in clear terms all your research phases, starting from the first step of formulating research, then setting hypothesis, then analyzing data. So each and every step is going to be planned and advanced. So in the research design, what we are going to discuss about is, we are going to see, we are going to say, we are going to elaborate, what is this study all about? Why do I do such kind of study? Where am I going to carry out this research work? And what type of data is required for this research work? Whatever data I require, where am I going to collect all this data? And what periods of time I'm going to include in my research work? What can be sample design? And what techniques I'm going to adopt for the purpose of collecting data from the respondents? Now, how the data, whatever I collected, is going to be analyzed by me, and using what style I am going to prepare the report. So all these things will be decided, planned well in advance in the form of a research design. Good. So depending on the purpose of your research, depending on the type of research, you can select different research designs. So if you want to study the behavior of the people, the characteristics of a particular situation, or the environment, a library unit, you can go for descriptive research design. That will help you describe the state of affairs. Then, if you want to find out some new ideas, if you want to find more and more information about a concept which is not known very popularly among the people, you can go for exploratory research design, where you'll go and explore and try to find out new things, new ideas, new concepts. If you are interested in testing hypothesis, then you can go for experimental research design. That is, you have an independent variable, you have a dependent variable, you have some kind of respondents. You want to study the impact of the variables, independent variable on the dependent variable. So hypothesis testing. In that case, you can go for experimental research design. Then comes diagnostic research design. So whenever you feel that there is a problem which occurs frequently, which needs solution, then you can design your research to be a diagnostic research design. Okay. Now, what are steps in research? So as usual, we say the first and foremost of any research is to formulate and identify the problem. See, what is the problem you are going to study in your research? Then you collect data, then analyze it, then you give a report of what you've done. Okay. These are basic steps to any research work. Then we talk about logical methods of research. So basically, we have got two different types of logical methods in research. One is deductive and the other is inductive. Okay. So in deductive logic, theory is tested from known scientific principles. See, we know a theory and we are testing this particular theory. For example, there is theory, for example, there is theory that the people, those who are aged, maybe 20 to 40, they spend more hours on internet. So this is a theory established, for example. You want to test whether this theory is okay or not okay. So what you do, you go to individual people, those who are aged between 20 and 40, you give some questionnaire, yeah, you ask them some questions, you analyze the question and you check whether the theory, what you have in your hand is being verified with this population or not. Okay, so a well-established theory is being tested, a generalized fact is being tested at individual level. That is deductive logic. We are moving from general to particular. As I told you in another example, general to particular. So people of this Madurai city are very good. Ramasamy is living in Madurai. He is also good. That is deductive logic. Then comes inductive logic. Here, by observing many individuals, by observing our sample, we are developing a theory. Okay. For example, you go and interview all the people, those who are aged between 20 and 40. You ask about their internet using behavior. Then you frame a theory that the people who belong 20 to 40, they are using internet more number of hours. So based on the individual observations, you create a theory which may be commonly used for the entire population. So this proceeds from particular to general. For example, you can say that, see, Ramasamy is good, Kandasamy is good, Veerachami is good, all these people are living in Dindigul, so Dindigul is also good. So from individuals, you go to a general statement. So this kind of logical study is called as inductive logic. Okay, you take any research study that may belong to either inductive or deductive logic. Fine. Then comes what is a scientific method. People say that when they say research, they say research should be systematic, research should be scientific. See, whatever may be the discipline in which you are trying to do some kind of research, the research should follow a scientific method. See, what is scientific method? So you can say that if your research work follows all the following steps, then you can say that this research is adopting a scientific method. So what are steps? First and foremost, you should identify the problem. So whatever problem you are going to investigate in your research work, that problem should be precisely and clearly identified. And secondly, you should conduct a review of literature. Whatever may be the problem you are studying, the related studies which were published already by eminent scholars are reviewed. And thirdly, you fix and determine the purpose of your study. Based on the purpose, you have objectives. And based on the objectives, you decide what are the hypotheses you are going to have for your research work. Then you have to design your study. So what kind of study you want to conduct? The historical research, case study method, survey method, or whatever the kind of study you feel like, you design. Then you collect the data, then analyze the data, then draw conclusions. It's based on the findings, you decide, you come to a conclusion that this is what I have found out, discovered in my research study. Once all these things are over, your findings will be disseminated in the form of a journal article, in the form of a conference paper, in the form of PG project or MPhil dissertation or PhD thesis, in such kind of forms, your research findings will be disseminated to others. So if a study follows all these steps properly, then you can say that your study is following scientific method. Good. But actually, who has initiated this scientific method? The credit goes to Francis Bacon, the first exponent of scientific method of doing research. In fact, scientific method can be applied in any subject. So you can carry out your research using scientific method in physics, chemistry, biology, botany, zoology, commerce, economics, political science, Tamil, English, any subject you can conduct scientific method of research. And the very important element of any scientific method is that verifiability. That is, whatever inferences, whatever conclusion you draw from your study, those findings, those suggestions, those concluding points can be verified. Okay, that is the biggest benefit of any scientific method. Good. Then, when you talk about scientific method, you should never forget to talk about Dr. S. R. Ranganathan's spiral of scientific method. Fine. See, when somebody asks Ranganathan a question, see, studying about libraries, its collections, meeting the requirements of users, how can it be a science? To reply it, Ranganathan added a chapter in the second edition of Five Laws of Library Science on spiral of scientific method. So in this method, he explains about the steps and phases that are required for conducting a scientific method on a subject. In this method, he talks about four cardinal points, four important points called nadir, ascendant, zenith, descendant. So what is the order of these four items? N, A, Z, D. Nadir is a beginning. Ascending means the process where the subject is growing. Z stands for zenith. Zenith means the highest point of something. Then D stands for descendant. You're coming down. So this circle, this will keep on going. The Ranganathan is given some kind of output from each quadrant. See, when you are moving from nadir to ascendant, you come across empirical laws. When you're moving from ascendant to zenith, you come across hypothesis framing. When you move from zenith to descendant, you talk about the fundamental laws and deductible laws. When you're moving from descendant to nadir, you're talking about verification of the laws or whatever you have found out. So this is a picture you can see here. Zenith is at the top, nadir is at the bottom. This is ascendant increasing, descendant increasing. And here, Ranganathan talks about four quadrants, four stages. But the first stage, the move between descendant and nadir is called as quadrant one. The stage between nadir and ascendant is called as quadrant two. The stage between ascendant and zenith is called as quadrant three. And the phase between zenith and descendant is called as quadrant four. So there are four quadrants. So first quadrant is between descendant and nadir. Second quadrant is between nadir and ascendant. Third quadrant is from ascendant and zenith. Fourth quadrant is between zenith and descendant. So in the first quadrant, you are experiencing the facts. The second quadrant, you are trying to get some induction and generalization, hypothesis framing. Then quadrant three, sublimation and again generalization. And quadrant four, you are deducing from fundamental laws. So this is what Ranganathan has given, a spiral of scientific method. This is spiral. It keeps on progressing. It keeps on going. Fine. Okay. Then comes selection of a research problem. It's a very, very important concept in any research. The first and the most difficult job for any researcher is to choose exactly the pertinent, the right problem for the research work. Okay. So what are the points you can keep in your mind when you're going to set a research problem? So please understand, when you are selecting the area, see that you are not selecting the subject and area where already tons and tons of research works were done. Enormous amount of literature was already published in that particular topic. It is a subject which is overdone. So don't take those topics because it's very, very difficult to find which is left out by others. And secondly, if you are a beginner level research, not well experienced, don't select controversial subjects. Okay. So those kind of subjects will be taken care by experienced researchers. If you're a first-time researcher, the MPhil scholar, or a PhD scholar, never ever take controversial subjects. Then don't take too narrow problems or too vague problems. They have to be avoided. See, in the name of research, you should not do a study something like this. You go to a college, go to BA economics students, you go to first year students, you take only males, only those who are staying in the hostels, only those who have laptops, and those who studied in Tamil medium till 12th standard, and you do research on how they are reacting to social media. So you need not take such a topic, which is very, very narrow. It's very, very difficult to research. And very importantly, whatever topic or the area you are planning to do research, that area, that subject should be familiar to you. And you should feel that there is a feasibility for getting all the related research materials, all the related resources for conducting this kind of research. See, normally what we do is that we go and approach an expert or a professor in the university, or as a researcher, you can go and read a lot of articles. You can find out whether this will be feasible, this will be possible. Are you familiar? Then you can decide on selecting a particular topic. Then very importantly, there are few things like the importance of the subject. So how relevant the topic is now, how burning the topic is now, how widely talked about the topic is now, you should see. And your qualification and your training as a researcher, you know what is your skill, you know what is your competence. So based on that, what about the cost involved? What is the amount you are going to spend for your research work? What is the time factor? How long you'll be able to spend for this research work? And all such criteria should be kept in mind before you select a research problem. So you should see whether you are well equipped with the background of the research work. Do you have enough money to complete the research work within its blueprint? And whether you'd be able to get enough cooperation from the people from whom you are planning to collect data. So all these things are there. It's very, very important. So if your answer is yes to the most of the questions, then you can choose and decide the area on which you are planning to do your research work. Fine. If you are going a research project on a topic which is widely known, where plenty of literature is available, then absolutely no problem, you can go ahead. Otherwise, for example, you take a topic and that topic is not widely studied by others. That is comparatively a new topic, not touched by many people. In that case, it's always better you conduct a feasibility study. You conduct a pilot study. So whatever study you are planning to conduct, the same study, do it in a micro level, in a small location. You look for the results and then decide. 1 minute. And then decide whether this topic is this topic is okay or not. So in the case of new areas, untouched areas, sometimes you need to conduct some kind of pilot studies, feasibility studies or preliminary studies. Okay. So once you choose a topic, the next step is conducting a review of literature. So what is a review of literature? So it is a process where you are trying to find out what are all the related studies, related researches, which were conducted by external experts, the same topic. For example, if you are conducting a study on emotional intelligence of college students, you should go and find out what are the people, maybe in America or in any other country, what kind of studies on emotional intelligence of college students were conducted already by renowned researchers and experts. Okay. You are going to read all those related research. You are preparing an evaluative report. which will contain the information what you obtained from such related reviews you collected. So in the review, you describe, you summarize, and sometimes even you can evaluate what is available in the review of literature. And this kind of a background study will give a very strong theoretical base for your research. And that will help you to decide what is the nature of my research work. Because I am going for an exploratory research, descriptive research, or case study kind of research, or survey research, what kind of research I should do. So in the review of literature, you'll be able to get a clear account of what was already published, what was already established in a particular research topic. So that will help you many ways. For example, a literature review, if you do it very systematically, that will provide a theoretical background for your study. See, you can have a background of what others have done. Based on that, you are going to do something new. And when you study whatever was done in the previous years on the same topic, you can always establish a link between what was done by others and what you are planning to do. So this review will act as a link between these two things. And apart from that, it will tell you, for example, if you are doing a research on emotional intelligence, you can say that, see, already this much is available in emotional intelligence. And my findings, how it is going to contribute to the already existing knowledge. So that review of literature will help you to explain how your research findings will add value to the already existing quantum of knowledge. Fine. And apart from that, when you are doing a kind of discussion in your research work, you can always integrate your research findings into the existing body of knowledge. So review of literature is very important. It helps you to find the gap in the current knowledge. It's very, very important. See, 100 research articles you have collected, you go through all the articles, but so far, nobody conducted research on that particular topic. There's a gap. So that research gap, you can find it only when you have a thorough review of literature. So you find out what is the gap in the research. Then you can increase the breadth of knowledge. See, whatever area on which you are doing your research, you will be able to expand your own knowledge on that area when you read lot of review of literature. Because every previous researcher might have done something different. So when you read all those things, your knowledge in that particular area will improve and increase. Fine. And you can get some points to delimit. You can get some points to decide the scope for your study. When you go through all the research papers, you will know what is the kind of scope limitation they all had. Based on that, you can decide what kind of scope and limitation or area of operation I am going to have for my research work. Then you can understand what kind of data is being collected by previous researchers, whether it's successful, data is available or not. Data is available, then what techniques were employed by previous researchers to collect data? Whether shall I also make use of the same techniques or not? Then, very importantly, you can avoid the duplication. See, if you don't do a thorough review of literature, then you have to reinvent the wheel. So wheel was already invented by somebody, you need not go and reinvent it again. So that kind of duplication can be avoided only when you have a thorough review of literature. And this review of literature will reveal the strength and weakness of the methodology adopted by the previous scholars, so that you can find out which methodology is better for your research. If there is a weakness, how I can overcome that weakness. So you can learn all those things. And if you want some hypothesis for your research study, the hypothesis also can be taken from previous research work. Even that way, review of literature is helpful. And based on the analysis of previous studies, you can prepare a blueprint, a conceptual structure, research methodology for your paper. Not only that, even when you want to develop your own questionnaire or schedule or interview tool, you can get enough hints from previous researchers. So dear students, review of literature is very, very important. Then comes formulation of research problem. So I decided the major topic. I went through a good number of research papers on related topics. Now, the next step is formulation of research problem. See, once you state your problem in a very, very general, very, very wider way, you see, is there any ambiguity in your sentence? Is there any confusion? You refine your research problem. And see, if you are successful in defining exactly the research problem, what you are going to do, then half of the work is over. The formulating research problem is defining exactly, stating exactly what you are going to do in your research work. This involves two steps. The first step is understanding the problem thoroughly. So you need to understand whatever problem you're going to read. So if you're doing a research on bibliometrics, you should understand what is bibliography, what are the different tools and techniques that can be used for bibliometrics. If you're doing a research on survey tool, survey method, if you are adopting survey method, you should know what is survey method, what are the tools and techniques for data collection survey method. So you should understand the problem first clearly. First, then once you understand the problem, then the problem is to be rephrased, should be stated very clearly in a meaningful terms. Only two steps. What is the first step? You should understand the problem. How to understand the problem? I should go and discuss with my friends, those who are doing similar kind of research. Or I should go and talk to the people, those may have expertise in the subject of my research work. I can talk to them. If it's an academic institution, normally we'll have a guide, a research supervisor, who is a well-experienced person. We can contact him, we can talk to him, and you will try to know more and more about the problem. And same time, apart from meeting your friends, your colleagues, apart from getting advice from experts, your guide or research supervisor, you can update yourself with the concept of your research by examining all the available literature. See, whatever literature is available, whether it's a journal article, book, or conference paper, whatever, you just go and browse the entire literature. See, you can go and do a review of two kinds of literature. One is conceptual literature, the other is empirical literature. See, conceptual literature means the theoretical papers, the papers which talk about the theoretical background of your research work. Okay, so they talk about theories. They don't talk about the practical studies. On the other side, we have empirical literature, where we go collect data, we analyze data, we bring out some results, and we give some suggestions. So that way, empirical research. So you should have a thorough carrying over of both conceptual research and empirical research for the purpose of understanding the problem what you are going to explore in your research work. So first of all, you should understand your research problem very clearly. And secondly, you have to rephrase, you have to use correct terminology, correct terms to express that problem in a very, very specific way. In a very, very unambiguous way, in a very, very transparent way. That is very, very important. So people, those who are reading your title should not be misled. They should not be confused with the kind of interpretation they take away from the title. The title should be very simple, but should be very clear. It should be very transparent. So by seeing the title, people should be able to understand what you are planning to do. For example, there's a title called Information Literacy Skills and Social Media Literacy Skills of Postgraduate Students of Arts and Science Colleges Affiliated to Mother Teresa Women's University Kodaikanal and Evaluative Study. So anybody who comes across this kind of title, they will exactly find out that. So this research is about evaluating two skills, information literacy skills and social media literacy skills. Of whom? Of the PG students. Where do they study? In the arts and science colleges. Which arts and science colleges? The colleges which are affiliated to Mother Teresa Women's University. It's very, very clear. So your research problem should be stated in very specific terms, very apt terms, should be clear to reach a very, very clear final the statement of your research problem, you can have any number of rounds. You have a general one, then you refine it. The second one, which is more specific than the first one. The second one is more analytical than the first one. The second one, which is more analytic than the first one. Okay, fine. Then go to third round, fourth round, fifth round. Each round, the title, the problem statement, what you get will be better than what you are getting in the previous rounds. So that is how you can go and formulate and decide upon the exact research problem. Good. Okay. So now I have decided my research problem. Then what are the variables I am going to include in my research work? So basically, we have two different categories of variables. One is categorical variable, which is also called as qualitative variable or discrete variable, which can further classify into nominal variable, dichotomous variable, ordinal variables. Fine. So they are non-quantitative data. Okay. See, dichotomous means yes or no question, something like that. Then comes nominal variable, ordinal variable. What is a nominal variable? See, simply we nominate something. There is no who is better, who is not better, who is higher, who is no such ranking. For example, you take gender, male, female. So we assign number one to male, number two female. So both are equal. There's no discrimination. No one is higher, no one is lower. So we are simply naming one to be male, two to be a female. Of course, you can assign any number. So those going after educational qualification. For example, up to 10th standard, you assign number one for them. Then up to 12th, number two, UG, number three, PG, number four, PH, number five. So you just, without any ranking, just assign some numbers. Those variables are called nominal variables. Then comes ordinal variables. In ordinal variables, there is an order of data. So there you can say which is good, which is not good. For example, you collect data in 5-point scale. Strongly agree to strongly disagree. Highly satisfied to highly dissatisfied. But here there is a ranking. Okay. They are ordinal variables. Fine. The second category is continuous variable or quantitative variables. Here we talk about data in numbers. Two different variables are there. Interval variables and ratio variables. Okay. Both are numbers. But in the case of ratio variables, there is an equidistance between two points. If you take first unit and second unit, there's an equal distance, which may not be there in the case of interval variables, but both are number variables. Fine. But in research, we talk about independent variables and dependent variables. A dependent variable is also called as outcome variable. An independent variable is also called as experimental variable, predictor variable, that is being manipulated. For example, you are having hypothesis something like this. See, impact of gender on the work efficiency. Okay, impact of gender on the work efficiency. Here, what is the independent variable? Gender is an independent variable. So we are manipulating gender. These are the males, these are the females. Let us see their working experience, working efficiency. What is the dependent variable? The outcome variable. What is the outcome? Their working efficiency. So working efficiency is a dependent variable. Gender is the independent variable. So we have educational qualification, nativity. All those things can be categorized as independent variables. For example, effect of revision time and intelligence on test marks of students. What is the outcome variable? Test mark. That is a dependent variable. What are the independent variables? Revision time and intelligence on test marks. Okay, fine. So then comes hypothesis. Once you know what are the variables you are going to use in your research, using all those variables, you will frame a hypothesis. Okay. So what is hypothesis? It is nothing but a mere assumption. We are assuming something which can be approved, which may be disproved. Okay. And in the terms of hypothesis, you are providing a tentative solution to a problem. Okay. The problem what you are proposing is only a tentative one. For example, you give a solution like something like this. Using multimedia, using internet technology will help the teacher to bring more children to score better marks. Okay, this is a solution you are giving. But how can we check whether the solution can be accepted, not accepted? You should carry out your research, collect data, analyze data, then you will finalize. So, hypotheses are tentative solutions. They are propositions whose validity is to be checked. We have to validate it, whether it is okay or not at the end of your research work. And these hypotheses are verified by experiments. At the end of the experiment, we check the tenability of hypothesis, we come to conclusion. Once the hypotheses are framed, they're tested and they are proved, then after verification, these hypotheses will become theories or principles. So in natural sciences, we term these hypotheses as tentative generalizations. In social sciences, we call them as normative principles. I think you are familiar with the term normative principles. Okay. So what are the basic concepts and hypotheses? Hypothesis can be a null hypothesis or it can be an alternative hypothesis. See, null hypothesis states that there is no significant relationship. There is no significant difference between independent variables and dependent variables. That is called a null hypothesis. Alternative hypothesis states that there is a significant difference between independent variable and dependent variable. So that is alternative hypothesis. Okay. So null hypothesis is always tested for its rejection. We are testing the null hypothesis either to reject it or to accept it. Fine. So whenever you are rejecting the null hypothesis, on the other side, you are accepting the alternative hypothesis. Okay. We'll talk about different types of hypothesis. We got many different kinds. As I told you, null hypothesis, alternative hypothesis, directional hypothesis, non-directional hypothesis, even your descriptive hypothesis. A hypothesis which states that there is an existence, there is a size, there is a form, there is a distribution of a particular variable. Okay, that's kind of descriptive hypothesis. It says that something is there, something is available there, something is not available there. Such kind of hypothesis are called descriptive hypothesis. Okay. And whenever you're talking about hypothesis, people normally indulge in two different types of errors. Type 1 error and type 2 error. So what are they? Please look at the table. See, for example, there is a hypothesis. The null hypothesis is true. Okay. Null hypothesis is true. So you're accepting it. Okay, null hypothesis is true. You are accepting null hypothesis, then it is correct. But if you are rejecting the null hypothesis, which is correct, if you are rejecting it, that's a type 1 error. Fine. Okay. On the other hand, there is a null hypothesis, but that is not correct. Okay, that is not correct. So you have to reject it. So if you are rejecting it, you're right. Instead of rejecting it, if you're accepting false hypothesis, that is known as type 2 error. So you should be very careful in avoiding these two errors in hypothesis formulation and testing. See, I told different types of hypothesis. One classification is given before you. Hypothesis of difference. It says that more number of females than males smoke cigarettes. So here we say that, simply say that more females are involved in cigarette smoking than males. This hypothesis of difference. Instead, if you are making your hypothesis very, very specific, for example, for every 1,000 children born in a particular country, 30 are dead. If you say that the percentage of female and male smokers, it is 60% to 30%, something like that. If you give exactly your proposition, this is called hypothesis of point prevalence. You are exactly proposing. Then sometimes you give a hypothesis where you talk about the association. For example, like female smokers are as twice as male smokers. So this kind of statement is called as hypothesis of association. Okay, fine. Okay, so we know what are the various variables. We have, based on the variables, we have set the hypothesis. Now we need to test the hypothesis. Okay. How to test the hypothesis? You have to test and find out whether you are going to accept the null hypothesis or you are going to reject the null hypothesis. Okay, that's what you're going to do. So to do so, you got two different kinds of statistical tests, parametric and non-parametric. So you can use a parametric test or you can use non-parametric tests. To accept or reject the null hypothesis, you need two things. One is you need to fix what is the significant level. So normally we have two significant levels, either 0.05 or 0.011. Anyone. Normally we have 5% significance. We test the hypothesis at 5% significant level. Then at the end of the results, you check the p-value, the probability value, or you check the table value. Based on that, you decide either to accept or reject the null hypothesis. Okay, fine. So that's about variables and framing and testing hypothesis. Next, let us talk about sampling. See, whenever you are doing a research where the population is very huge, your population is scattered over a large area, then it is difficult for you to go and collect data from each and everybody. So what you do is that, instead of collecting data from everybody, you select a few people from the entire population, you conduct the study. That is what is called as sampling. So sampling is a process of deciding a small number of people from whom you need to collect data, the one which represent the entire population. Fine. And you have to decide about sampling well before the collection of data. Fine. See, for example, if you want to know how good St. Xavier's College of Education is, you need not go to Palayamkottai and ask this question to each and every citizen of Palayamkottai. No need. Okay. Randomly, you select some 10 or 15 or 20 or 30 or 50 students, 50 people. You ask questions, you get the answers. Then you generalize. So this is what St. Xavier's College of Education is all about. That is what is called as sampling. Okay. And what are the characteristics of sampling? For example, you have decided that I am going to ask questions from these 10 people, and whatever answer I get from these 10 people will be representing the entire population. So how your sampling should be? Your sample should be truly representative. So it should exactly represent the population it belongs to. Okay, first thing. And secondly, the kind of samples you select should be help you to avoid sampling error to the maximum extent possible. So sampling error should be avoided. So you should have such kind of sampling mechanism. Then your sampling should be decided in the context of funds. So based on the amount you have, you can decide. So you're having 10 crore rupees, you can go to entire India and collect data. If you're having only 10,000 rupees, restrict yourself only to Tamil Nadu. Fine, that way. And when you are selecting a sample, your sample should be selected in such a manner that there is no bias. See, bias is controlled in your sample selection process. So these four are the important criteria that are to be fulfilled by any sampling design. Okay. And what are the various types of sampling? We have probability sampling and we have non-probability sampling. See, what is this probability sampling? It means that, for example, so you want to collect data from the faculty members of a particular college. The college has got around 100 faculty members. So 100 faculty members, they form the population for your research work. But you are not going to collect data from all the 100 instead. You are going to select only some 20 faculty members from whom you are going to collect the data. Fine. So under probability sampling, all the 100 faculty members are having equal chance, equal opportunity to be selected by you as a sample. So that kind of sampling is called probability sampling, where each and every sampling unit is eligible to be a sample. But in the case of non-probability sampling, for example, you go to a college, you say that, see, I am going to conduct a research. I want to collect data only from the language teachers. So here there is no probability because only language teachers will be a part of your research work. Fine. So what are the various types of probability sampling methods? We have simple random sampling. See, for example, you go to college, you want to collect data from UG students. Some 2000 students are there. So what do? You take a small 2000 chits of papers. You write the names of all the 2000 children. You put it in the box. And you take some 200, 300 from the box. Whatever name is picked by you, they are going to be your samples. It's a random sampling method. It's only lottery method. Okay. And we have stratified sampling. In stratified sampling, first of all, we decide what is our strata. You go to college, you collect data from students. So you decide what is my strata. You can say that I want to get some questionnaire filled by UG students, some by PG students. So I got two strata now. UG students, one strata, PG students, another strata. And after deciding my strata, within each strata, I will adopt a random method to choose randomly a couple of students. Fine. Then comes systematic sampling. For example, you are having a list of 1,000 employees of your organization. You want to conduct a survey on the efficiency of your organization's working. So what you can do is that the entire list is available. So randomly you set a number, for example, number 4. Okay. And randomly you set another number, 7. So how you're going to set your sample? First number is 7. The gap should be 7. So you'll be calling these people, number 4, 11, 18, 25, 32. That way it goes on. Okay. Randomly, systematic sampling. Then comes multi-stage sampling, especially when your coverage area is very large. Suppose you are doing a research study in South India. What you can do is that, first, you can choose clusters, Tamil Nadu cluster, Kerala cluster, Andhra cluster, Telangana cluster, Karnataka cluster, 5 clusters. Within every cluster, you can have strata. Within every strata, you can go for randomized selection of candidates. So all these methods belong to probability sampling. And what about non-probability? There we are not providing equal opportunity to everybody to become a part and parcel of my sample. For example, accidental sampling or convenient sampling. For example, you want to collect data from a district central library. So what you do, you go with the questionnaires, go and stand in front of the gate of the district central library. The first 50 users who come to library, the first 50 users, you collect data. That is called convenient sampling or accidental sampling. Then comes purposive or judgmental sampling. See, when you go to collect data, you are very specific that I am going to collect data only from these students. I want only these students. It's a very purposive sampling. You go to a class, you want to do a research on the students, those who are doing very well in mathematics. You go to a class and ask children, those who are scoring more than 70% marks in mathematics, please stand up. A couple of students will stand up. Only those students will be your samples. Matters do very purposive sampling. Then comes quota sampling. So we ourselves decide what is the quota we should take from every place. So quota you decide, it is not randomatic. Then comes snowball sampling. One shows others. So here, sometimes we may not be knowing our samples. We move from known samples to unknown samples. See, for example, you are conducting a study on the people, those who are affected with HIV/AIDS. Okay. See, nobody will tell you that, yes, we are all the HIV patients who come and get data from us. No hospital will give a list. So what you can do is that, for example, you know one patient, HIV patient. So you go to him, you collect data. Then you tell him, "Bhai, I'm doing a research. Kindly tell me, is there anybody you know who is also affected with HIV/AIDS? That fellow will tell one or two fellows, address and all. Then you go to them and collect data. This way, they will tell somebody's names. So you'll go from one place to another place. You are getting the samples from the samples. So that kind of sampling is called snowball sampling. So these are different kinds of sampling. Okay. So what is the essence of sampling? Very simple. You go to a college. You ask some 10, 20 students about the college. And you decide and tell, this is what the whole nature of the college. Okay. By collecting data from a sample, you are giving final impression about the entire population. That is what the simplicity of sampling. If the sampling size of sample is very small, it's always better to go for purposive sampling. In stratified sampling, it is a combination of purposive sampling and random sampling, because it is a purpose. You divide this data. I have gents and females. I have PG students or MPhil scholars. You decide this data and then you go for randomization. Fine. Good. So whenever you're having a list of your samples in the list form, you can better go for systematic sampling. And systematic sampling is very good and used especially when you have to collect data from large number of people. For example, in your school list, around 500 students are studying 11th and 12th. You arrange all the fellows in an order and you say every 10th person will be included as my sample for my study. That is called systematic sampling. Okay. Then comes, there is a method. When you talk about random sampling, how to select the samples randomly. You can use either lottery method, as I told you. You can write the names of each and every individual. You put it in a box and you drop and take the slips. And whatever names are picked, and there'll be samples. Lottery method. Then comes a scientific method called Tippett table of random numbers. There's a person called Tippett. He has developed a table of random numbers. You can go and get some random numbers from the table and you can use those numbers for the purpose of select the samples. Blindfolded method, very simple. So when you want to take a lot, no, you blindfold somebody. So they will go and pick up some chips. That will be the sampling for your units, for your studies. And when you talk about sampling, you remember that there are two laws. One is law of statistical regularity. The other is law of inertia. So both these laws are related to the laws of sampling. See, for example, if you take a topic like impact of closed access on user community, then closed access is the independent variable. What is the outcome variable? User community is the dependent variable. And the person who conducts public opinion is called as poll star. Like superstar, they are called poll star. They go and conduct public opinions. Like during the election time, they go and predict who is going to win a particular constitution, who is going to rule the country. So those kind of studies, no? Those who collect public opinion, they are called poll stars. When you are exactly aware of what is the number of people of my study from which I should select some sample, that is called as finite population. You want to get data from a college, you know exactly the college is having around 2,464 students. It's a finite population. Then what is sampling frame? A complete list of all sampling units. Okay, whatever sampling units are there, you prepare consolidated, a comprehensive list. That list is called a sampling frame. Fine. See, quota sampling is used especially in public opinion service. See, government has introduced a new service, a new scheme. After 3 or 4 months of its implementation, you want to conduct a study to find out to what extent that government scheme is successful. It is reaching the people. It is benefiting the people. There you can make use of quota sampling. As I told you, accident sampling, it is a case of non-probability sampling. Okay. Good. This is a screenshot of Tippett table of random numbers. Fine. So far, we have discussed about 9.3. What is a research design? What are the different research design? What is a research problem? What about the review of literature? How to rephrase your research problem? What are the variables? How to frame hypothesis? How to test the hypothesis? And what is sampling? So all these things are discussed. Let us move on to unit 9.4, where you talk about the methods of data collection. So especially in the case of social sciences, you need to fix well in advance what is the method, what is the tool you are going to use to collect data from the respondents. Whether you are going to use questionnaire method, interview method, observation method, or you are simply going around library records, or you got some kind of scales, some kind of checklist for evaluating the performances. That is what we will study in unit 9.4. See, data collection. So we talk about data. So data is something which is not processed. Okay. Collected previously, afresh ones. Okay. They are very, very fresh. For the first time you are collecting data, they are original data. They are called as primary data. But what about secondary data? the data which was already collected by the people. Sometimes the already collected data was subjected to some statistical analysis. So that is called a secondary data. Fine. Okay. So what are different methods of collecting the data from the respondents, observation, interview, questionnaire, schedules? And apart from that, nowadays you have a lot of other methods also. Something like warranty cards, consumer panels, you go to a shop, you collect, purchase a particular product, they'll give you a piece of paper, they'll ask you to write questions. They'll ask you to write your feedback. So that's kind of a data collection method. Then we have some mechanical devices, some projective techniques, depth interviews, content analysis, many more are there. Let us discuss a few of them. One is questionnaire method. It's a very, very popular method, which is almost used by the people in the survey research. And here, what you do is that, see, once a topic is decided, you prepare a well set of questions that will help you to find out answers for your research work. This questionnaire is given to the respondents. The respondents will write the answers by themselves using their own handwriting. That's called a questionnaire. The questionnaire can be structured questionnaire. In the sense, you have designed everything in advance and you're having almost pre-coded questions. That is, you are mostly including or all the questions are multiple choice questions. But every question, you give few options. The respondents simply have to choose any one option. They don't have anything else to play. That kind of questionnaires are called as structured questionnaires. Fine. But please understand, pilot study is essential for testing questionnaire. Whenever you want to use questionnaire, you have to prepare a rough questionnaire. You have to go and conduct a study in a smaller way. You have to find out the feedback you receive from the participants on the quantity and quality of questions included in questionnaire. Then you modify it, you refine it, then you make a final questionnaire. Good. So McCornum has categorized questionnaire to three categories. Mailed questionnaire, the questionnaires are mailed by post or mailed to the participants. Group administered questionnaire, you call all the 50 students of a class, you hand out a questionnaire to them, you ask them to fill and give it to you. That is a group administered questionnaire. Then personal contact, you go and meet each and every staff member, you hand it over to them personally, you get the answer from them. That is personal contact questionnaires. Okay. So in most of the questionnaires, we have closed-ended questions. That means they provide only options for each and every question. You have to select any one option from the alternatives available. They are closed-ended questionnaires called structured questionnaires. Then comes open-ended questions, flexible questions, unstructured questionnaires. In these questionnaires, so we are asking questions. We are not providing any options for the respondents to answer. Instead, we give a free chance to the respondents. We give 3 or 4 lines. We are asking the respondents to write the answer. So those kind of questionnaires are called as unstructured or flexible questionnaires. But in this modern world, you can make use of even online tools for data collection. Something like SurveyMonkey or Google Forms or Microsoft Forms. These things can be used for collecting data. At the same time, even using your own mobile phone, there's a tool called the Cobot Toolbox, which can be used for collecting data from respondents with the help of mobile phones. Fine. See, when you are framing the questions, what kind of questions can be included in questionnaires? So people talk about scales. So people use many scales to measure the attitude of the respondents. For example, we have Likert scale, a very popular scale, which was invented by Rensis Likert. So we have a 3-point Likert scale, 5-point Likert scale, 7-point Likert scale, and the 9-point Likert scale. For example, we have 5-pointed Likert scale, something like this: strongly agree, agree, neutral, disagree, strongly disagree. So 5 level of the Likert scale. And second, you have Thurston scale, which was developed by L. Thurston, 1928. Here, we are giving points to each and every reply. See, we are asking the respondents to give comments on a particular concept. lot of answers are given at the bottom. Each answer is given a rank. For the first question, give 1 mark. Second, first answer, give 1 mark. Second answer, 2 marks. Third question, 3 marks, something like that. So depending on the answer given by the respondents, the answers will get weightage. That is Thurston scale. Then comes semantic differential scale, a scale which was used for measuring the attitudes of objects, events, or concepts. The one which was developed by Charles E. Osgood. Okay. Then Gutman scale. So normally a Gutman scale will have binary answers like yes or no answers, which was invented by a gentleman called Louis Gutman. Apart from that, there is a scale called sociometric scale, which was developed by Jacob L. Mornio, where we are trying to measure the social relationship between the respondents, among the respondents. So many scales are there. This is an example for Thurston scale. For example, you can see statements are there. Left side, they have given weightage to each and every question, every answer, 1.2 to 11. Fine. Gutman scale. So they give you a list of opinions. It is understood that the person who accepts, the person who agrees with the milder statement is also agreeing another milder statement. For example, I'll tell an example. Here, 4 answers are there. So we talked about the experience of an individual in a particular game station, for example. Okay. If he says that, I always feel sad and I can't stand it, it means that he's accepting, he's agreeing the previous one also. That means the one who always feels sad may feel sad most of the time. Okay, the one who is accepting number 4 option is automatically accepting number 3 also. The one who says that I feel sad or blue most of the time, indirectly he is agreeing that he often feels sad or blue. So the readers, when they are answering the respondent, one who is accepting a particular level, it means that he is accepting the previous, former, broader levels also. It's a Gutman scale. Semantic differential scale, for example, you ask the people to give ranking for supermarkets. Okay, these are the ranking. You're asking whether it is a modern store or old fashioned store, according to they'll mark. The low prices or high prices. So both the extremes are given. The respondents are asked to rate in between these scales. They are semantic differential scale. Okay. So that's one method called questionnaire method. Then comes schedule. So both are same almost. Maybe the only difference may be the type of questionnaires. You prepare questionnaires. You give it to respondents. The respondents will write the answers. But in the schedule method, we have the same questionnaire, but we are not asking the reader to answer. Instead, we are writing the answers. We are writing the answers. Okay. Sometimes the researcher is not able to go and collect data. He'll appoint a person called enumerator. So enumerator is a person appointed by the researcher who will go to the people and collect data from them by writing the answer by himself. Fine. And the schedules, you know, if you are making use of a schedule to measure the attitude or opinion of the people, it is called as rating schedule. Okay, good. Then comes observation. So observation means you are keenly seeing what is happening around you. You are watching carefully a particular action, a particular event, a particular program, a particular set of people and how they behave. You collect it. There's an observation. So the structured observation and the unstructured observation, 2 methods are there. So structured observation means you are deciding well in advance, I am going to observe only these 2 10 points. So during the research process, you will observe only those 10 points, not more, not less. Structured observation. It is being used in descriptive research studies. Fine. In the case of unstructured observations, so we don't have any pre-planned list of things to be observed. On the spot, whatever you feel like observing, you keep on observing and moving. That is called explorative research studies. You're using unstructured observation. And the observation can be either participant observation or non-participant observation. In the non-participant observation, The researcher is not going to join the group of respondents. He stays away from the respondents, a bit far distance, and he observes people and gets answers. In the case of participant observation, the researcher becomes one of the participants. Okay, he joins the samples, he becomes one of the members of the samples, and he observes. So this participant observation can be either covert observation or overt observation. So what is overt observation? In the overt observation, the researcher openly tells the participants that I am going to join your group and I am going to observe you. In the case of covert observation, the researcher is known to the respondents, but he doesn't reveal that he is going to observe them. Fine, good. So sometimes non-participant observation is also called as disguised observation. Okay, so many a time biologists, physicists, astronomers, so they all accumulate their knowledge only by observation, because they have long telescopes and periscopes and something like that. They will sit in the high top roof building and they'll always look at sky. Okay, so observation is a major method of data collection for the biology people, physics people, and astronomers. And in the observation method, we use a design called four cell design. Okay, fine. Let us go to the interview. What is interview? Interview is another method of data collection where you are meeting the people face to face, ask questions and collect data. Fine. So there may be direct person investigation. You go to a person, sit in front of him, you ask questions, collect data. Indirect person investigation, you contact a particular person through mail or through WhatsApp or through telephonic call or by mail or by WhatsApp. Somehow you reach the people and you contact the data. You collect data. Indirect personal investigation. Or even sometimes people do interviews on Zoom meetings or Jitsi meetings, something like that. Even that is also, even Skype, even WhatsApp video call. So these are different ways of conducting indirect personal investigation. Then you can have either structured interview or unstructured interview. So in the structured interview, you know exactly, you know what you are going to ask. In the unstructured, you are not having any fixed list of questions. At the time of interview, you ask questions and you get the data. Focus interview which talks about, which concentrates on a particular issue. So in the whole interview, they will discuss only about that particular small issue. Okay, that's a focus interview. Then clinical interview, especially when people are in the hospital suffering from psychological issues, no? They conduct this kind of clinical interview. They go back to the younger age of the patients. They collect some kind of interview data. And sometimes there are some interviews called non-directive interview. Here, the interviewer, the researcher, is not having any set of questions. Okay. He's only acting as a catalyst. He will motivate the respondent. He will encourage him. He will appreciate him. And he will try to persuade him to give the reply to all the questions. So he's only acting as a catalyst. So non-directive interview. Fine. So in the data collection, even we can have something called focus group interviews. So very focused, you select very oft 20 students of your school and you conduct an interview. You conduct some interview for collecting data about the performance of teachers. That is focus group interview. Then you got some other projective techniques. What are the projective techniques? We do something, we'll ask respondents to watch and see it and to give their opinion. So based on the opinion given by the respondents, we collect data from them. For example, ink blot test, which was developed by Rose Charts. It says that you take a white cloth or white chalkboard, you squirt ink from your pen. It will go and place on the chalk or board with the different patterns. You're asking your students to tell what does this ink tell them, the squatting tell them, how the ink is squatted over the board, over the chart. So everybody will give a different opinion. So based on the opinion, we collect data from them. Sometimes we ask the people to tell a story based on a picture. We show a picture to them. Okay, what is the picture? The one side, all the lorries are carrying the cut wooden pieces. And the other side, the lorries are carrying oxygen. By showing this picture, you're asking the respondents to tell the story. So the way they tell the story depends and reveals what kind of persons they are. Right? There are many such kind of stories are there. So even storytelling can be used for the purpose of collecting data from them. Okay, good. Then comes library records. See, sometimes we collect data from library records. Okay, daily log registered. So which department is visiting the library most? Whether UG students are coming or PG students are coming. Among the UG students, who visits the library most? And who is not at all visiting the library? So all these things can be taken from daily log registered. Then book issue register, computer use register, reference book usage register, library accession register, diary of library events, and guest register. This way, a library maintain many number of records. See, even the information available in these records can be taken as a base for conducting your research. Absolutely no problem. Okay, good. Then come checklist. See, whenever you go to a supermarket, you go with a checklist. Okay, you first item you read, the item is available, you take and put it in the cart, you give a tick mark against the item. You check it. Whenever some people come to your class for inspecting your class, what did they come with a checklist? Name of the teacher, class being handled, number of children attending the class. Then questions come. Notebook corrected or not? Assignment given or not? Model test given or not? So all these things are there in the checklist. Okay, the checklist will help to structure a particular person's observation. A checklist helps a person to structure how he is going to evaluate a particular person. So either these kinds of checklists will provide an option for you to select either yes or no for a question. In sometimes, even these checklists will provide a small space for the researcher to write his comments on the answer given by the respondent. So these are different methods of collecting data from the respondents, starting from interviews, questionnaire, schedules, all these checklists, all these things can be used for the purpose of collecting data from the respondents. Fine. So I think 9.4 is over. Now we have to discuss about 9.5. Data analysis. Maybe I'll come back to you a bit later. And thank you so much for watching this particular video. Thank you so much. So let us meet in the next class, focusing on 9.5, 6, and 7. Thank you so much.